Beautiful. Welcome to Reset TV and our talk today, Racial Justice is Climate Justice. I'm Vishal. I'm going to be hosting or facilitating this session with three amazing activists. I'm really, really humbled to be here with you guys. Cameron, slightly humbled, but still humbled. So we have two activists from the Stop the Manganese and Extinction Rebellion Internationalist Solidarity Network, Esther Stanford-Hosse and Kofi Mawuli-Klu. And we've got Cameron Joshi from Global Justice Rebellion. We're going to be talking about, it's weird to call this a conversation, because already that seems like it's not allowing for the gravity and importance of what we're about to be discussing and talking about. But hopefully, we'll be covering topics like reparations and the ongoing legacy of the enslavement of African people, racial justice, the environmental movement, and what's really, really relevant to most environmental activists at the moment, or most activists of any type, except for probably the far right. But any activist that we want to affiliate with, which is how do we communicate with each other between movements? How do we create a movement of movements where we can collaborate with each other? And just before this talk, we were just having a chat about the importance of disagreement and how we can have different approaches, different backgrounds, different cultures, different ways of doing things, disagree on things, but still come together and organize against and for our shared causes. So I'll ask our speakers to introduce themselves. Maybe just say a little bit about your background in activism and what's led you to this moment. Oh, and the other thing is, this is in the context of a really important event, which is the 1st of August reparations lockdown happening in Brixton. So maybe Esther, if you could start by saying a bit about yourself and also about what's happening on the 1st of August.
Sure. So I am most commonly known, as a reparationist. And a reparationist is a reparations scholar activist. And most people misunderstand what reparations are about, so I know that we're going to come on to that. I'm also a jurisconsult, which is a legal specialist in jurisprudence, the science and the philosophy of law. And my background in activism spans really 20 years of being involved with primarily the international social movement for African reparations. And during that process, I also began to encounter other reparationists who were from other communities and nations that had also experienced colonization, forms of enslavement, genocide, and dispossession. So we refer to that movement as the People's Reparations International Movement. And it was in the process of really kind of getting more deeply involved with the African struggle that I encountered other people's reparation struggles, because it was a natural convergence. And when you look at reparations holistically, you then begin to also recognize the importance of the fact that we're seeking to repair the harm, not just to ourselves as people, but naturally in terms of our environment and the whole ecosystem and the damage that's been done by colonization. So it was actually a natural evolution in my own growth and learning and consciousness being raised as an activist. The nature of the problems that one felt one was seeking to confront and overcome actually became much more deeper as I sort of got much more entrenched in the movement and realized that we couldn't have effective repair without system change. And in order to have true system change, it's going to take masses of people and a convergence of many different types of movements, and in fact a merging of rebellions. And it was in that sort of interface of merging rebellion that I encountered Extinction Rebellion as an activist from the Stop the Mangamizi, We Charge Genocide Ecocide campaign. And we were there from the very beginning and helped to co-found the Extinction Rebellion Internationalist Solidarity Network.
Beautiful, thank you, Esther. Kofi, would you be happy to share? Tell us a bit about yourself.
I describe myself as a Pan-African community advocate for global justice. And I came to that from a background of professional education in law, taking critical legal practice from jurisprudence. But my passion for community engagement and community education led me to focus more on how we could promote inter-community dialogue so that the issues that confront my African heritage communities that are also relevant to all other communities, we could find ways of working together on them. Also, I came into this country from my birthplace, which is in Ghana in West Africa. I come from the Ebefon Aja communities of the Beto that spread and are divided by the 1884-1885 Berlin Conference. Borders of present-day Ghana, Togo, Benin in Nigeria, and therefore have brought into my activism issues of coloniality and decolonization. And of course, precisely because of my background as well, I have passionately been engaged in issues that relate to the environment. Because environmental racism is very much part of the global apartheid racism that white supremacy has inflicted, you know, upon not just African people, but also all colonized peoples that have been authorized by white supremacy racism. And it is in learning to distinguish between white supremacy and, you know, also European contributions in terms of international solidarity to our common struggle for the emancipation of humanity from all forms of oppression, exploitation, and injustice, that global justice began to loom large as something that unifies or should unify all peoples of conscience who really want to get to the root cause of the kind of divisions that the global elite likes to foster amongst oppressed peoples, and to be able to, yes, as Esther said, you know, work on merging our resistance into a global torrent of rebellion that will take us all to a common rendezvous of victory, as Emisiza puts it. I see very much the issue of how the Pan-African liberation struggle that has largely shaped my perspectives on everything, my world view, how that in itself is inconceivable without putting it within a context of global justice. And if anybody is very well informed about the historical realities of what we call the Mangamizi, that the continuum of the crimes against humanity and the crimes against Mother Earth from the times of the chattel enslavement of African people right through to direct colonization to present-day neocolonialism, we'll see that the threads of international solidarity that had sustained this resistance, the intergenerational resistance, and the fact that even though various movements from the various communities have sprung up, you know, now more than ever before, confronted by the climate and ecological crisis, which is really threatening all life forms on the planet, the agency of movement of movements work for us to take this forward has become something that we all need to pay attention to, unify around. So yeah, this is where I'm coming from.
Yes, thank you. And I hope this conversation takes us closer towards that. When we come onto it, we'll come onto it. Let's introduce Cameron.
Hi guys. Can you all hear me fine?
Yeah.
Brilliant. So my name's Cameron Joshi. I a bit of history about my activism is I've got a much sort of smaller history in activism than most people here. So I've only been an activist for about 2.5 years. And in that, I found Extinction Rebellion about 1.5 years ago. So around the time before the very first action of blocking the 5 bridges in London in November 2018. And I was really moved by the call to non-violent civil disobedience, non-violent direct action, because that really mirrored the sense of how serious the climate crisis was getting that I got only from, you know, cursory glances at the news. So I joined XR and I spent the next 1.5 years on and off around the edges, trying to sort of make stronger in XR the narrative of climate justice and within that anti-racism. And I actually failed, really badly failed in April 2019. But then luckily a group called Global Justice Rebellion, they didn't fail, they formed and did a really good action in October 2019. So I joined them and I've been working in Global Justice Rebellion ever since. I do other stuff. I work at an NGO called Global Justice Now. That's an NGO that essentially works on the motto of solidarity, not charity. So I work very much with the ideas around the fact that the world we have today is structured by economic oppression. It's structured by economic extraction. The global south develops the global north. It's not the other way around. So I work very much in that context. But in terms of race specifically, my background is that I'm half Iranian and half Indian. So I have like a rare type of heritage there. And my politics has been shaped by my Iranian background quite a decent amount. Iran is a country that during the 20th century had its democratic government overthrown. And in political turmoil, it was replaced with a dictator, brutal dictator. And this happened, it was instituted by the secret services of the UK and the USA. This is part of a large amount of things that happened during the Cold War, and that really shaped my politics. But in terms of person of colour, the kind of discrimination or racism that I face is of a different category to most black people in the UK. And as someone who isn't working class, for example, it's also of a different category to someone of my race who's also working class. So my experience of racism is more of a kind of insidious kind that is not obvious. It's not the same as my parents faced when they came to this country. And apart from that, I'm also, I was disabled for a long period of my youth. So that really shaped my ideas around oppression and how oppression works. And I see, and as a result of being a mix of privileged and oppressed, I see often how people think on both sides of this divide.
I'm already getting really pumped up. I'm really excited. I think I want to share a little bit about myself because you will have. So I've been an activist for a little while, but I stopped around Occupy London to study to become a doctor. And I then worked as a doctor for about 3 years. And I left medicine for a reason I think is really appropriate to this conversation here. I was working in accident emergency and a lot of the time we're just keeping people alive. And I got tired of just keeping people alive. It's not good enough to just keep people alive. We need to have quality of life. Mm-hmm. And the challenge I put to all rebels, all environmental activists is, what's the point of keeping the human species going on if we do not have racial justice? How can Kofi and Esther be speaking about ongoing and continued ecocide and genocide, you know, present day Holocaust? Mm-hmm. How can that be okay and appropriate, and us be talking about perpetuating the amount of time that we have here? So both things, you know, really important to go together. So I came back to activism, not to join the climate movement. I came just to work more on quality of life. And then I started to find that the biggest impact to people's quality of life is the environmental breakdown and catastrophe that is going on. And now I'm organizing more around community democracy and trying to create system change in a movement of movements kind of way, but in a hyper-local fashion, in parks in Hackney, in parks in Tottenham, and mainly based around the Black Lives Matter movement. I'm really privileged. I might as well be like, I'm your token hyper-privileged person, even though I'm of Indian origin. I don't really feel like I've been very oppressed. And so I don't want to speak from that background. So let's crack on with our first question. We're going right in the question is, where do you still see the legacy of the kidnapping and enslaving of African people in our society, within our own lives, right here and right now? And one thing I wanted to say is, from the community circles and discussions we've been having, it's really important. Like, the majority of people listening to this are going to be white, right? We know that. And I, as a non-white person, feel pretty uncomfortable when I hear about this question, when I hear the answer to this question. So I just really ask people to be prepared to feel uncomfortable, feel discomfort. And if you're not feeling uncomfortable, then we're probably not listening appropriately, point in the right direction. And only from that place of discomfort can we start to heal and start to make the changes we need to create an equal society. So yeah, would anyone like to start? Can I see a hand if you feel ready to go?
So I think I will start. Yeah. For me, I mean, this is a really appropriate question in light of the fact that we are preparing to engage in the reparations rebellion groundings on Saturday, the 1st of, we say Mosiah, but most people will know it as August. And this is going to take the form of a lockdown of a large part of Brixton from Windrush Square to Max Roach Park, including the whole of that part of Brixton Road. And the reason why we are taking this action, we normally march on this day from Brixton, Windrush Square to Parliament Square, and we hand in what's known as the Stop the Mangamizi, We Charge Genocide, Ecocide petition. And this petition is really laying out a modern day case as to why reparations are a key demand and process, actually, that African heritage communities, whether we're born here, whether we're born in Abya Yala, the so-called Americas, including the Caribbean, or whether we're born in Africa, is something that our communities have been engaged in by way of a process from actually the first time that we were kidnapped in the 1400s. But it's important in a UK context because we have traditionally marched on the 1st, because the 1st of August 1833, there was the passing of the Abolition of Slavery Act, and that did not come into force until the 1st of August, actually 1834. Now, what this particular act did was it legislated that enslaved people supposedly would receive emancipation, but that didn't really happen because we were forced into a period known as apprenticeship, which meant that we had to continue to work for free on in terms of slavery, chattel slavery. And are you hearing?
Yeah, I am. Okay. Sorry, I was shocked.
Sorry. And so, but what this act also did is it legislated that enslavers would receive compensation for loss of their property in African human beings. And we know that the debt that was amassed as a result of the government borrowing money, the equivalent of £20 million in 1834, that money wasn't paid off until 2015. So it meant that taxpayers in Britain were helping to service that debt that was so huge that it was like 40% of the budget for the UK Treasury. So that injustice is something that we felt was important to protest against, because every generation actually has been articulating, advocating, organizing for reparations and being part of the process of repair. But yet the British government continues to say, well, reparations are not the answer, and refuses to actually even engage in a dialogue with our communities, which is what we've been calling for, by way of a dialogue not only with the government, but with British state and society, because we know that most people are miseducated, misinformed, including a lot of our own people who receive the same miseducation via state education. So because we are not being heard in our demand for the UK government to establish what's known as the All-Party Parliamentary Commission of Inquiry for Truth and Reparatory Justice, we have decided to take a different action this year, because they've got too used to us just going and then giving us just a basic acknowledgement that they receive our petition and our covering letter. And we haven't had a significant response apart from in 2018, when we did get a response from Lord Ahmad of Wimbledon, who repeated the government line that reparations are not the answer. So our communities want to be heard. They want the opportunity to talk about and to show how the legacies of the Maangamizi continue to impact on us today. And that's what the Stop the Maangamizi petition tries to outline, and it outlines 12 instances of genocide and ecocide that are affecting us today. It's not about what we're not referring to even what happened to our ancestors. That's when the system started. And we know that we cannot change what happened to them. But we're actually talking about the legacies that we live with today that actually began with them. And so we're continuing on what they started. And some of those things which people will be thinking, what are you talking about? Because one of the things that you'll hear is that, well, slavery ended hundreds of years ago. We're not responsible, we didn't do it, okay? So racism. Everyone, I'm sure by now, has been hearing about racism. So anti-Black racism, and a specific form known as Afrophobia, anti-African prejudice and discrimination, began with chattel enslavement. So if people have been concerned and have been engaging in these anti-racism protests, then that itself is a direct legacy. It's not normal that actually we should have racism on the planet. This is just not normal, especially when the majority of humanity who birthed the minority of humanity are the ones that experience it the most. And we're the ones who are still trying to get justice. So So that is one easy thing. Then we're talking about the land grabs and the ecocidal and genocidal dimensions to what's happening in terms of extractivism. And we know the impact that that's happening not only for African heritage communities, but all peoples as well. Dispossession that continues. So the fact that you have many people in Africa who are becoming climate refugees in their own continent, crossing the Sahara, literally almost dying because they have been unable to breathe in their own countries. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about debt bondage that still keeps African, Caribbean, some Asian nations in a form of servitude. Okay, these are some of the historical legacies that continue to strangle our home countries and therefore our people. Racist immigration policies. I mean, this notion of putting borders and visas and saying some people are welcome and some are not, where does that come from? Because when they colonized, that wasn't something that they found in our societies, okay? Nutricide, the way in which agribusiness and all of that is just poison, all this poisoning of the food and the water systems and the pollution, all in the name of business. There's something radically wrong there. Unemployment, malemployment, all the types of violence that we experience, structural violence, direct violence, sexual violence, you can see a lot of these traced back to historical enslavement, including reproductive violence, which is something that African women are still being targeted, especially in this time when there's a concern because of the climate and ecological crisis, and we're seeing the rise of eco-fascism, which gets played out in terms of, well, you people over there have too many children. And so we need to engage in depopulation measures because there's too many of you, as opposed to looking at the overconsumption of people in the global north. So these are just some of the manifestations. And a big part of it is that we as African heritage people have been dismembered. We were taken from our homelands, made into other people. So we no longer even sometimes identify with ourselves because we've all been mixed up, depending on which nation colonized our own indigenous ethnicities. We speak different languages. So even the ability to organize, to come together collectively to stop the harm in our time, as previous generations did, has been challenging, but for movements such as Pan-Africanism. So these are some of the reasons why repair or reparations, as we also know, that's why it's essential. And these are the impacts on our communities today. Of course, there are lots more. Another thing that's been very topical in a UK context has been not only we know about the disproportionality in terms of COVID-19, but also gun and knife crime, particularly impacting youth of African Caribbean heritage. And we can trace this directly in terms of the analysis around what's known as black on black violence in service of white domination. So black on black violence and self-annihilation in service of white domination, as has been theorized by some of our scholars, such as Dr. Amos Wilson and others. So yeah, that's a little bit of what we're talking about. And we believe that this commission, All Party Parliamentary Commission of Inquiry for Truth and Reparatory Justice, is an important mechanism to have that dialogue so that we can explain the reality of our lives, because many in the majority of this society do not fully understand the lives that we lead and what has been actually our histories of how we've come to be here and the interactions that we have been having here, despite being here for centuries.
A phrase that's like coming to my mind is, only when those who are unaffected are as outraged as those who are affected will justice be served.
That's right.
And one of the easy ways for us to not be outraged is for us to simply not know what's going on. And so thank you so much for sharing just a taster of your experience and your dedication to this area. And people can read the full petition on the Stop the Manganese website.
Yes, and it's on change.org, Stop the Manganese. In fact, this is the post.
Yeah. Move off screen for a second so they can see it at the bottom there. There we go.
Stop the Manganese, MANGAMIZI .com. That's the website. Google it, you'll see it come up.
Encourage everyone to read that.
And sign it and share it, please. Yeah.
And think about how it's implicated within our own lives and how we're implicated. Kofi, I'd love to come to you now and ask you the same question. Where do you see the legacy of the kidnapping and enslaving of African people in your own, in our society now?
Thanks, Esther, for that. You know, it answers a lot as far as I'm also concerned. But the fact of the matter is that for me, my journey into activism started quite very early. And it is connected to what my parents and grandparents wanted for me. My parents demonstrated to me great love because they wanted and did everything to ensure that I will develop my human potential to the full and made me to understand from my childhood days, I really clearly understand that teaching from my father, my mother, my grandparents, who I was fortunate to see, that, you know, apart from God, as they put it, you know, I was no lesser a being on this planet, and no greater than any other human being. And that teaching of do unto others what you like to be done to you was so strongly ingrained in me. I was let into my father's, you know, study where he had many, many books. And actually he led me to read quite early before I started school, actually used that to study the autobiography of Kwame Nkrumah. And the Kwame Nkrumah is this Osagyefo, this, you know, liberator who devoted his life, his entire life to trying to encourage and lead African people towards their total emancipation and emphasized the need for unity amongst our people to achieve that objective, but also the importance of us standing tall and with stretched out hands to other peoples of the planet Earth who make up humanity. So this is the kind of background that gave me the knowledge and the courage and the inspiration to step forward into activism. And from that teaching from my parents, my grandparents, and which was reinforced by the values I learned from our indigenous community of the Ebefon Aja ethnicity in West Africa that we call collectively the Betol, we grew to understand that the individual had a responsibility to the entire community, that your rights to a full human development were premised on what contributions you made to the collective well-being of everybody. And as much as there could be differences amongst us, you know, individually, each person was only as strong as the entire whole of the community, and all, of course, also people around us, you know, and indeed all of humanity. These were the values that were inculcated into me from home, from very, very early. But then as we engaged with others, we realized that there was this huge gulf of inequalities that particularly in the aftermath of the overthrow of the government of Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah in Ghana in 1966, which the British intelligence services, the CIA, Mossad were all implicated, we saw a degeneration in the quality of life of everybody around us. Our parents who didn't have to care about school fees, you know, healthcare fees and so on, as all of a sudden these things were becoming issues for them, you know, jobs and so on and so forth. So, you know, began to see how Ghana, which became independent in 1957, and we were born into a very optimistic society where everybody looked, and I was this black, the emergent black star of Africa out of the doldrums of colonialism, and was stretching its hands across the continent and diaspora of Africa and origin, all African people to unify and crush the last vestiges of colonialism on the continent, and also challenge global injustice. Then, you know, we saw everything start, you know, start to change. And it was there that even the quality of education that we had been receiving, you know, was also beginning to suffer in terms of the ideas that began to be peddled, you know, in our schools. And, you know, in school, I was encouraged actually to challenge those ideas that sought to just teach us about, you know, everything white as superior and everything, you know, African and supposedly, you know, black as inferior. How there were attempts for us to internalize inferiority complexes while we worship, you know, anything that was presented to us as white. And I mean, it, instinctively, I challenged those things, not just from what I learned from the autobiography of Kwame Nkrumah, what I learned from my parents and family, but also what I learned from my community. And then what I was also reading about in the world, because these were also times of the challenge to racism across the world, you know, particularly in the United States of America, in Europe, where our black communities, the civil rights movement was on the upsurge. You know, so these things shaped my views on life. But then, you know, over time, what I began to see in terms of some of us who tried to take into our consciousness the idea that we were human beings as equal to every other, you know, human that walked this planet, and that we needed to hold up everybody, you know, regardless of whether you were African or not, you know, we needed to show respect, you know, to every human being, you know, encourage people to stand up and be proudly seek, you know, to develop their human potential to the full. We saw that a lot of people around us, particularly Africans, were beginning to, you know, actually let these inferiority complexes destroy their sense of self, you know, destroy our communities, you know, people, I mean, the whole worshipping of whiteness, you know, the disrespect of our own, anything that was African, right up to the point of, you know, straightening the hair, bleaching the skin, you know, not being able to even speak our own indigenous languages, disrespect our own indigenous knowledges and cultures, you know, and yeah, your road to success was, you know, how seek actually pursue alienation of yourself from your community, from who you are, you know, into embracing, you know, everything that was foreign, everything that was white, You know, I just couldn't stand that, you know. And in school, I ran into lots of problems with the kind of friends who talk like me. And we just could, as young people, we just couldn't understand why it was that when you seem to stand up for, you know, what was seemed naturally the correct thing to do, you know, I mean, then you fell foul of the rules of the law and so on and so forth. So that's how, you know, battles of activism really started from school, you know, right through and pursued that. But an interesting part for me was how the pursuit of knowledge, you know, once I rejected the kind of thing I thought was being taught in schools to demean me and to demean my people, you know, I sought alternatives, right? And I think my whole world was opening to me about how other peoples across the world, not just Africa, but over Asia, you know, the Americas, so-called, you know, the renowned Sabi Ayala, even in Europe, people were standing up against injustice. And the more I pursue that, I see the historical threats, you know, of, you know, even Europeans who, you know, suffered death in order to stand up in to challenge the chattel enslavement of African people, you know, who to challenge colonialism and who stood alongside us. You know, when I read about, for example, our resistance movement, like the Pan-African movement, it came to recognize that, in fact, the first Pan-African Congress, you know, funding for it, included, you know, donations from Asian, you know, freedom fighters. You know, I mean, and I could see, you know, for example, what the Cuban Revolution, you know, and revolution in China, you know, meant to Africans, you know, the war rallying around, you know, these are my youthful days, rallying around the defense of the people of Vietnam against the war that was imposed, you know, upon them. All these things make me understand at that point, you know, how internationalist solidarity was important to upholding, you know, humanity and upholding human rights, you know, and in terms of challenging all that was wrong, you know, around us. So for me, the whole question about what is this legacy? Yeah. For me, that this legacy, as negative as it was in terms of seeking to demean, you know, me and people who look like me and so on and so forth, there is also that legacy of resistance that, you know, just curiosity and the search for knowledge made me to pursue. And that is why, up till now, my point is, and of course, one of the interesting things about my whole life journey was I had the opportunity to spend almost a year in Cuba in the 1970s, you know, and then I went on to study in the what is the Union of Soviet Socialist Republic. That's where I learned all, you know, before, you know, coming here. And then I could see that actually with all the challenges that human beings face, they people could work to try to build, you know, alternative forms of society that even though they were not perfect, you know, could provide, you know, better quality of life for people, like free access, you know, to education in Cuba and the Soviet Union, you know, free access to healthcare, that these societies, you know, right from childhood encourage people to be whatever they wanted to be, you know, and you could see these things. And these were not perfect societies, but at least human beings could demonstrate that they themselves, you know, could alter their circumstances in such a way as to begin to give themselves the best, you know, of what was possible, you know, in their circumstances. So that strengthened my conviction, you know, in justice for everybody, in social justice. And as I began to understand the world, you know, more and see that the interconnection with all forms of oppression and injustice, and that the unity in resistance, rebellion, refusing to accept any unjust order, in a position of unjust, refusing to accommodate yourself, you know, to any form of injustice, not only against you, but against every other being on this planet. That is what gave you, first and foremost, a quality of life mentally. Even if your material circumstances, yeah, you know, were bad, I mean, once you took control of your mind and you focused on the ability of you as a human being with other people around you, mm-hmm, you know, to reshape things, then you really could withstand, you know, all this temptation to accommodate yourself to injustice, normalize it, and so on and so forth. And so for me, the question of quality of life, you know, was also one of the mind with which you view the world. Your worldview was very, very important. And I think that is where I began to concretely understand what racism was all about, how divisive it was, how damaging it was, and how that was one of the worst pernicious legacies, you know, of chattel enslavement and its impact, not just on African people who went through the horrors of chattel enslavement, mm-hmm, but upon all, you know, indigenous communities that got colonized, both in the global south and in the global north. And then, you know, the continuity of that system of, you know, colonial foreign rule, you know, up till today in its form of neocolonialism. But even with that, to always have hope in the ability of human beings to unify their efforts and defend their humanity, and in that sense, challenge things like the current ravages of the climate and ecological crisis. And this is, it is in this process that from organizing as a young person, as a student, you know, in the Pan-African liberation movement, you know, through its phases of challenging colonialism and now neocolonialism, embracing reparatory justice, and also global justice, because the interconnections between the African liberation struggle, the struggles of all colonized peoples, the struggles of all people of conscience, who even if they came from nations that oppressed others, could stand up even against their own nation in defense of what was correct. You know, this is what gave me the hope, you know, to resist up till now. And then, you know, through formations of the Pan-African Reparations Coalition in Europe, the Stop the Mangamizi with Child Genocide Ecocide Campaign, encountering Extinction Rebellion, and we'll have that discussion after this, encountering Extinction Rebellion and seeing, you know, from at first glance, its major weaknesses, but also seeing the huge potential that was there, you know, and I learned that you don't go approach anything in life expecting perfection to be delivered to you, you know, from the very start, right? There is a challenge to get into it, to recognize the potential in even whatever is negative, right? And seek to add and enhance the positivity. We always have a unity of opposites. The positive and the negative are always there together. And it is a challenge to, you know, help to see the positive and enhance it through your own efforts and not waiting for somebody to present perfection to you on a silver platter. And that's how we in the Stop the Mangamizi campaign approach Extinction Rebellion. And with all the challenges we've met, it's not been easy. But today I can stand and say the contributions we have made to Extinction Rebellion, but also the contributions Extinction Rebellion has made to our own struggles, right, shows that if we take on the challenges that face us and see ourselves as part of the solution and not, you know, just see others as the problem, right, then, it, you know, the impossible can be achieved by us. After all,
yeah,
every generation can only be what, the best of what they are waiting for.
Yeah. Yeah, let's do it. You know, yesterday we were making placards and banners about, and then the one which we're kind of coming up with is like, who still benefits from slavery? And I was like, oh yeah, who still benefits? And I was like, oh yeah, you know, people in the West are still benefiting from slavery. And as you're speaking, I realized that no one benefits. It's all an illusion. And I'm so grateful that you gave us that journey from your connection to the indigenous wisdom that we are all equal, that no one stands over anyone, that we're all equal. Because when I look at my upbringing, that's not what I was taught. Yeah, of course, my parents taught me that philosophy, but when I went to school, and every part of this society is about hierarchy, domination, and oppression. And whether you go for the standpoint of racial injustice, which is probably the greatest system of oppression that people, that leads to suffering or unnecessary suffering of human beings, or any other kind of oppression, we are all experiencing it. And I also really appreciate the kind of, yeah, that the breadth of your perspective to all oppressed struggles. And if we come together, we can really shift this around. And the legacy is deeply psychological. You know, for as long as we don't understand ourselves as interconnected and equal, we'll continue to perpetrate these things. So maybe that's a way in which we can reflect on this. I'd like to bring you in, Cameron. I was wondering if you had anything that's coming up for you you'd like to share.
Yeah, I mean, that was brilliant.
Yeah. Thank you, Esther and Kofi, yeah.
Yeah, so, like, that's great to hear, guys. The thing I was going to say, I mean, I feel like you guys have told people a lot of what, especially white people in this country need to hear, but also lots of other people too. And I wanted to speak to people who are neither black nor white, who are people of colour in this country, which there are loads. So one thing, though, before was that, I mean, I don't think people quite realise like how equal in standing Africa and Europe were before the systems that now come to dominate the world came about. There's like a series on BBC iPlayer called Civilizations, and I think it's like episode 4 or something. There's this guy called David Olusoga, and he goes to this painting, and it's a painting of Lisbon in the 16th century. And in Lisbon in the 16th century, there are, in this painting, like black people who are selling stuff at markets, black people in the painting who are driving like canal boats. And there's also like black knights, black priests, like people of really high status in Lisbon in the 1500s. And that's not something people really realize, that we've had links for a long time, Europe and Africa. And those links have been on equal standing for a long time. If you go to the V&A, this museum in London, if you go to the basement, there is artifacts from a sort of early modern civilization in modern day Nigeria. And they have caricatures of white people from their perspective, caricatures of Europeans in ivory with really long, thin noses. And that's just something you don't see, because we have lived in a world for so long that's economically destroyed Africa and other places. Mm. And, you know, what happened? I mean, also at that time, there was something called Benin City. I think it's called Edo or something like that before. That's a huge city that had walls that were 4 times longer than the Great Wall of China. Walls between all of its neighbors, all of its neighborhoods. It had underground sewage. It had street lighting. And, you know, it was bigger than Lisbon at this time. And what happened to that city is it was burnt and destroyed in the late 19th century. So what was that thing that turned Europe and Africa from dealing with each other's equals into Europe destroying Africa's history and destroying its countries and its people? Well, that thing was the Industrial Revolution, and it was that kidnapping. So that is one of the legacies that we have today, is the way the world is now. And the reason why that's relevant to people of color as well, who are not black and who are not white, is because it was those systems that practiced on the people of Africa that they then came for the people of India and the people in the Middle East. And, you know, it was those same systems they used against us to occupy our countries and extract wealth and move us around as well. And that's still got a legacy today. So most people of color in this country, you know, I'm still shocked that white people don't understand this, but you know, they're not automatically, you know, anti-racist when it comes to black people. They have an extremely complicated relationship mm-hmm. with black people in this country. Mm-hmm. And that's not just because of colonialism. Before the kidnapping of mm-hmm. Africans in Africa by Europeans, there was a slave trade. For example, in East Africa, that involved Africans being kidnapped and taken to India in the Middle East. And there are still African communities there right now that are descended from those slaves.
Mm-hmm.
But that isn't what made the world what it is today. So whilst there's still that legacy, and it is part of people of color's history, it's not the same as the European slave trade, but it did create an anti-blackness that exists in Indian culture and in Iranian culture and Arab culture and other Middle Eastern cultures and other cultures in Asia. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's something that if you're a person of color in Extinction Rebellion or the environmental movement, you know, it's not enough to just go, well, I'm anti-racist too. We have particular communities that we need to work in and work on. And that's something that we can do, you know, right now. And it's not just because it's the right thing to do. You know, as I said before, the systems that were used on black people have come to be used on all of us. This is something we're all invested in. And it's the movements that black people all across the world that are building, they're the movements that will lead all of us out of these systems of economic destruction, of extreme racial prejudice and brutality. You know, I look to Black Lives Matter and I see not only, you know, a movement which can really empower black people, but it's something that can empower all of us because we're all being destroyed by this system.
Yeah, thanks for that, Cameron. Yeah, and I totally relate to that from like my cultural background as well. I'm really glad you brought that up. I've got a question for you, Esther. So obviously the reparations rebellion lockdown is about getting the Stop the Mangamizi We Charge Genocide and Ecocide petition to Parliament. There's a lot of people who aren't going to be able to do that, so they'll sign the petition. Of course they'll sign the petition. They should be typing it in now and signing the petition. But we all have a role to play in the perpetuation of the continued ecocide, genocide, and oppression injustice. And I guess the question I kind of want to like circulate is, what actions can we be taking now to start making reparations? Because, you know, like Extinction Rebellion, one of the movements I've made personally is I'm tired of asking the government to make a change, and I'm working with communities to make the change, to take the power and create them. And I want to give people an offering. Let's not stand and wait for the government to change, because they're going to be the last ones to change. What can we be doing? What would you like people to be doing if they listen to your stories?
I think the first thing is really around us educating ourselves, making ourselves much more aware as to what these issues are. What is the nature of the harm? And therefore, what are the attempts that are being made to repair the harm? That's really, really key. Because many of us start these conversations or even our own analysis from our own knowledge perspective and foundation. And that's largely informed by not only our formal education, but the experiences that we've had in the world. So learn about the movements that are championing repair, okay? Learn about their histories. Learn about the different community perspectives on repair as well, because there are different community perspectives because of the nature of colonization and how that impacted on us, in some cases differently. So that's where everybody can start. But it's more than consciousness raising. Once we've got a better idea, it's about the way that we organize today. So we have to be engaged in community organizing. Campaigning is important. And of course, taking direct action is important. For us as African heritage communities, we're not just relying on a sort of plea to a government. We think that that is important in terms of accountability, because the harm hasn't stopped. And we know, even in terms of the economic extraction, the report that was done in 2016 by War on Want, Britain's New Colonialism, that tells us 101 companies registered on the London Stock Exchange control over $1 trillion worth of Africa's key mineral and energy resources, and that this is legitimized by people in government today who sit as shareholders on boards of these companies. So the extraction, the Maangamizi, is continuing and it has material consequences. So we have to find ways of linking up our actions, and we have to stop some of these companies. We have to stop that plunder and pillage today, because it impacts on all of us when we have millions of climate refugees who have to then go in search of a new home. And because people in Europe have been miseducated about what the governments today are still doing in their name, then that's kind of like, well, where are all these refugees coming? No, we don't want any immigration. And we know that that was a big feature in the last elections. We're also engaged in self-repair, because the most important part of a repair process is what we do ourselves within our communities. And we know that communities, we are have intersectional communities. We're part of, sometimes we've got a main one, but we're also part of different communities. So we engage in what's called African heritage community self-repairs, because that's what we have to continue to do for ourselves. Once we know what the impact of our history has been, of not only in terms of the negative stuff of what has been done to us, but also our resilience, the way that we've always resisted, the way that we've still managed to build family and community and nation, and find ways to carry on our culture that give us joy and actually continue our civilization building. That's really, really important. But there are things that we can be doing on a local level, in terms of local governance, local organizing, local policy development around issues that are of concern to us. So we know that most people who care about any issue enough, who do any type of campaigning, activism, it connects in some way to the Maangamizi. Not just for African people, because as has already been explained, what was tried out on us got tried out on other peoples, yeah? And so we naturally, the world that we know today, that we've all come to be in relationship with each other, has been created as a result of this history, yeah? And that's what we encourage our people to do, to engage in, we talk about Pempamzie planning, and that is really an Adinkra kind of symbol that talks about a weaving together. Because out of all of this diversity, we've found ways to unify around the big issues that matter the most. And the theme that we are rebelling in terms of our rebellion, reparations, rebellion groundings this year, is uniting to stop the Maangamizi for our very survival. Because this is no longer about, well, I don't like you and you've done this to me. This is about the impact of all of this means that the system that we have in place is so rapacious that none of us is guaranteed a quality of life. None of us is necessarily guaranteed that future. And so if we care, we have to find a way to make sure that we can bring about those guarantees of non-repetition. So that it's not just about fighting to save oneself now. It's about ensuring that we create a world where none of us has to fight this struggle again. Mm-hmm. And certainly not one that we pass on to the younger ones now, who are coming into consciousness, who are seeing that there's something radically wrong and a huge state of disrepair, and who are really searching and seeking ways to be the difference and to be the change. Mm-hmm.
Got a lot of work to do.
We have, but the work is going on. I think what we need to strengthen is the linkages. Mm. The linkages, because the work that's going on is powerful. Yeah. And that we've got the technological means. There's a lot of things that go wrong with it, but we have the means to be able to do things that in previous generations it was much more difficult, but yet they were able to do sometimes much more. In terms of, make those big systemic and structural changes.
And it seems like a cliche, but you know, the first point you made, like, knowledge is power, like, and we are hidden from these realizations and understandings. We're hidden from alternative ways in which we can be with each other. We're hidden from the damage and harm that's caused. And you mentioned businesses and the government, but really the thing that really gets to me is how I can hear what you say and it can move me right now to anger and action, but tomorrow I'll be buying a coffee. And the damage and harm of that coffee or that consumption or buying sugar from Tate and Lyle or whatever, Billingtons and all that crap, that my actions are still perpetuating this. And how addicted we are, you know, how deeply addicted we are to this way of being. And what I really, really hope is that through what's happening with the Black Lives Matter movement and the coming together of our separated and segregated communities, because that's, you know, what colonialism's done to us, it's segregated us, divided us, through us coming together and sharing our stories and experiences on a human-to-human level, not just through Zoom, that it'll be so much easier to break ourselves from this addiction that is perpetuating the harm. And so, again, just so grateful that you guys are taking the time to, like, share like this with us and take us on that journey of re-educating.
Yeah, and in fact, we do have those models because Kofi did mention in terms of, you know, his own upbringing and the sort of principles around internationalist solidarity. And that's like, there's a long kind of trajectory of that. And certainly, as a Pan-Africanist in the Pan-African movement, we've had those, that a lot of that was going on decades ago. And it seems like we're forgetting those examples. So what we also have to do, I believe, is amplify the voices of our communities of resistance in the global South. Many of us are connected to those communities as diaspora communities in the global North, but that's where we can get the real, you know, we've got our hands on the pulse there because they are having to resist and struggle in ways that we could perhaps never imagine. And I feel that part of what we can do, as much as we experience, yes, racism, for me specifically, anti-blackness, Afrophobia, there are still degrees of privilege that we have that our brothers and sisters on the other part of the world where we come from do not have. So we have to recognize our own positionality. And I believe we have to work every day very hard to undo that system that is continuing to hold down, you know, the masses of humanity. And part of what any form of oppression does, any form of colonization, it dehumanizes.
Yeah.
Not only those who hold the levers of state power to dehumanize others, but those who have become subjugated and subject to the the oppression and domination of others. So we all have to sort of do our bit to remove those levels of dehumanization in us that can make us be complicit. And yes, even though theoretically we might know these things, still rush to go and look for the latest, I don't know what people have, because I don't have all those gadgets. But, you know, every year they're bringing out iPhones and all these things, but look at the destruction in terms of the genocide in the Congo. We have to care. Something is wrong when we have a society where we don't care about these things.
I think for me, where Esther and also Vish, where you were, you know, I've gone through various phases of activism and done various things in different parts of the world. And I'm at the point where I reflect a lot and would like to see how we can, in activism, without losing our militancy, our passion and determination to, quite frankly, overthrow this system of global injustice and replace it with one of global justice uncompromisingly. I still give a lot of time to thinking about the impact, and Esther touched on it as well, the impact of this global system of oppression in a way that dehumanizes not just the perpetrators of the crimes of genocide and ecocide, but also, you know, those who are victimized, you know, and meant to feel, therefore, that they also have to act, think and act like their oppressors, you know, even towards themselves in terms of disrespect of who they are and disrespect of everybody else in a rat race, you know, to, you know, subject somebody to some form of injustice in order to gain. Yeah. And that has so caused so much division. And therefore, a fear of each other that we are even unable to face the truth and confront who are the true oppressors. They've put us in situations where, you know, many want to be like the oppressor, right? Because they terrorize us and they say you cannot be any different from them, you know. Mm. So there's so much attempt, even on the part of the oppressed, to be like the oppressor and copy their ways and so on and so forth. And I think that the fear, the insecurity, the suspicion it creates amongst ourselves, the division that it creates amongst people is something we need to confront.
Yeah.
And when I think of it, one of the things that we need to do, particularly those of us who have some experience in activism, is to try and step back, you know, and try to put ourselves in the mind to empathize with those who are caught up, you know, in this sense of not being able to emancipate themselves from the oppressor who, in the words of Steve Biko, you know, have entirely given their minds, you know, to the oppressor, right? And one way in which I think we can do it is by creating truly human relationships, person to person relationships, you know, not necessarily in big crowds of, you know, massive demonstrations, but try to reach out and encourage each other to reason through things, to share our life stories, you know, and to develop the ability of the art and skills of listening to each other, to even listen to uncomfortable truths, you know, which, you know, sometimes you meet people who are so beaten down oppression, they can't think of the world as any different. And the tendency is for an activist is to condemn them and shy away from them. But I think that this is the time more than anything else where we are confronted. The real, you know, evidence is there that, you know, all of us are going to lose this planet. We are going to lose this life, right? If we don't work together, at least the majority of humanity, to understand what is going on and to contribute, even from positions of doubt, you know, self-doubt, you know, suspicion, you know, disbelief, to contribute, to start contributing the little that they can to the effort to undo this harm, to understand and undo this harm. You know, we must claim no easy victories that change is going to be, you know, a walk in the path. It's going to be difficult. But we can't also make that change without massive numbers of people. And this is where, you know, I think there's value in what Extinction Rebellion has set out to do. And with all the shortcomings and the imperfections and so on, you know, it did, you know, it has put out a real challenge about how do we, you know, create space where we can all come together and help each other to begin to confront this system that is now endangering all life on Earth, to begin to make sense of it and to support each other to begin to make steps towards making change. And I think, you know, this is where, if we talk about what should we do, I mean, in addition to all that Esther has said, which is, you know, important, I think that we should also begin to be more human to each other.
Those
of us who are activists have to also learn the patience, you know, of finding the best possible ways of communicating and encouraging people to communicate with us. And communicate even if they are unsure of what they're saying, even if they say the wrong things, right? Let's at least create the kind of human relationships that encourage people to begin to communicate, to engage in dialogue, to relate to each other. And out of even just ordinary conversations, you know, with people in our family, with our neighbors, you know, with even strangers in the park, you know, we will be able to build that critical mass of people who at least say, even if I don't understand everything else, the one thing that I know I have to do is to start from somewhere to be the change, because there are others also trying to be the change, and together we will be this grand change
that
we can make possible. So for me, in addition to all that I said, is to learn to be more human and build this, you know, rebuild this, you know, Gail put it there, let us rediscover our human family. And with that human family, every kind of change is possible together.
Yeah, I was reminded today by Will Franks about how there's this feeling that, like, activism is about loss, or like, I'm using my privilege, I now have to give up this, this, and this to now campaign for this other thing. Actually, we all only have things to gain from this struggle. When we defeat the neoliberal, the neocolonial kind of, you know, beast, we all gain, because we regain our humanity. It's extremely important to remember that. We've been having these hosting community circles, so bring people together in Hackney and Tottenham to discuss issues around racial injustice, and it's been bringing together, in a facilitated way, people who don't normally speak to each other. You know, in Tottenham, which is 85% BAME community, Hackney, I can't remember what the percentage is, and there's deep segregation, such deep segregation in these communities, and it is really uncomfortable to admit to it. And these circles are bringing together, you know, about 70% white people, 30%, 20% local black activists kind of coming together. And we had this, we asked the question the other day, in the 6 weeks since George Floyd has died, what changes have you seen to your local community and to your life? And a Nigerian woman, I won't say her name, she had her three kids with her, and she said, for the first time in my life in this country, and the first time in 20 years I've been here, I feel safe in my own neighborhood, because people look at me and they smile at me, and now I feel safe enough to express myself. And I thought, wow, that's big. It's so subtle, but it's so big. It's because people are rediscovering their humanity, their ability to listen to each other, see each other as equals. And now we now have this woman who now is free to express herself, come into her power and share her stories and shift her neighbors, maybe the whole of Hackney, who knows what her potential is, just because we regained this subtle skill and process. And it's just emphasized to me, you know, it's these big things we're trying to change, but we all have a responsibility to decolonize ourselves in this very, very basic way. And when we do it in that way, not just about changing government policy, but when we do it in a deep psychological and emotional way, we, at every step, we have something to gain. I realize we should be talking about climate justice or climate change somewhere in here. I mean, we have been, right? We have been. And this is the point of this conversation.
Yeah, exactly.
Is climate justice. But
exactly.
Esther, I was wondering if you might be able to kind of hone in a bit more between the link between the climate and ecological catastrophe and racial justice. And just one thing before we do that is, you mentioned earlier how we have this link to the people who are more directly experiencing physical suffering as a result of ecocide and the ongoing, colonial oppressions of different countries. And one thing I was just reminded of is how that seems to be only a temporary reality, and that the ongoing degradation of our climate is going to lead to more pressures and sufferings of people closer to these shores, and how that will lead to the rise potentially of eco-fascism, and that threat is coming closer to home. But anyway, if you want to touch on that, you can do, but otherwise just the links between the racial justice and climate justice movements.
Sure. I mean, if anyone else wants to go ahead, Cameron, you've spoken the least. Yeah. So maybe you should start, actually.
Yeah, let's start with Cameron. School us.
Okay. I mean, there's a few interesting things you guys said earlier, so I'll just go on that very quickly. Kofi was talking about how we need to really talk with empathy and build relationships with people, even if they say the wrong thing. I think that's true. Something to add is that a lot of people don't have the patience to debate with people things that they've had to debate time and time again. And there's a limit to that, but I agree totally that strategically, we need to be able to encourage people that, we have to talk empathetically with people who don't understand fully what people of color are going through. And I think that's, that's right. So in terms of race and climate change, so we've all sort of touched on the idea that we have an extractive and unequal economic system. That's the basis of a lot of the problems we're seeing. And that's how race and climate change are connected. They come from the same system. So for example, colonial history plays a huge part in this. So if you take the example of the Congo in the late 19th century, the Congo was colonized by Belgium. And when the Congo was colonized, it was split into different regions that were owned by corporations. And these corporations brutalized people in order to extract raw materials that would then benefit the host country, the colonizer country, Belgium. So that was what colonialism was about. And half of the people of the Congo, which is over 10 million people, died during that 50-year period. That's more people than that died in the Holocaust. So that was an absolute genocide of what happened. And at the same time, in order to take back the rubber to Belgium, in order to take all these raw materials, they destroyed the environment as well. Yep. And that microcosm is essentially how the world works today. Mm-hmm. We still have private corporations that are headquartered in the West, in London, who take resources from the rest of the world. So this still happens today. About $2 trillion of wealth in net terms goes from the global South to the global North every year. So that's $2 trillion more than any aid or any remittances that go the other way. That's every single year. So we still have a world which is extractive. We still have a world that's unequal. And that's, and the thing that's used to justify all this is racism. The reason why people don't care about other people in other countries quite often is because they're racialized as different and inferior. And we're race is used as a way to make us compete with each other instead of unite. And race is used to divide people that, if only we united, we could get rid of this climate crisis. We could really change the world if we wanted to. So race comes from the same system. Racism has the same origins as the climate crisis that we see today. Racism is the reason. It is one of the main reasons people do not care about the climate crisis. The climate crisis will overwhelmingly affect people in the global south. The climate crisis will cause 700 million people to fall back into poverty in the next few decades. It will cause hundreds of millions of people to have to flee their homes. It will cause 47 countries are at risk of civil conflict, just as Syria has been, because of the combined effect of climate and other socioeconomic problems. That's enormous. And all of those countries are in the global south. all those people falling back into poverty in the global south. This is global south being hit by far the worst. So, you know, if we want to fight climate change, we don't have a choice. You have to fight racism. If we want to get the numbers on the street for rebellion, then we're going to have to sacrifice those in our movement who don't want to talk about racism. No, we're going to have to just sort of ignore them. And we're going to have to really reach out to people who face racism daily, who are willing to stand up about it. People like Black Lives Matter and other movements. You know, I heard someone tell me that in October, if we'd had 4,000 or 5,000 more people, well, you know, we might have won. We might have really forced the government to concede. And I'm looking at Black Lives Matter marches, anti-fascist marches, and thinking, well, that's where those people are. Mm. So I really don't understand, you know, people who don't want to talk about racism. I think it's not only, you know, the right thing to do, the thing that, you know, we should think about almost first when we think about climate crisis, but it's just the thing we have to do in order to get to where we want to be.
So the collaboration between different movements is something that Extinction Rebellion has done not very well. And Kofi and Esther, you've been part of the movements, you know, for a long time. And I was just wondering if you could share either, I don't know what's most appropriate, like, because this is crucial, right? This is crucial. We need to come together as people from all sorts of different standpoints. You know, for many people, the biggest form of oppression they experience is the possibility that their children might have an impact in their standard of living as a result of climate breakdown. And they're being drawn into action. There are other people for whom they don't even think about climate change because they can't put food on the table. And there are so many different oppressions, and the same system is reproducing all of them. And the way we can get the numbers, as Cameron just said, to change this system is to bring them all together. So how do we learn from the experiences of people like yourselves who've been trying to draw people together, to sing from the same, to collaborate where necessary, be different where we need to be different, and, you know, how can we learn from your experience so we can step into being the collaboration of movements we need in order to make meaningful change?
I think the real challenge there, Vish, is making a real effort to embrace difference. And that has been one of the most difficult things for many within Extinction Rebellion, because they came into a movement, you know, with certain perspectives, you know, shaped the movement initially with those perspectives. And I felt that that's what each, at least not everybody, but a good number felt that that's what it has to be, you know. And then they approach communities from which XR did not come, which were not participants in shaping what XR started off being, to say, come and join us, but this is what it has to be. Okay. And I think that has been the problem, and it's taken quite some work, you know, and learning experience for XR to recognize that that is no way, you know, we're going to confront, you know, even the climate and ecological crisis, let alone all the other things that, you know, people are concerned about. And this has been a difficult learning journey for many within XR. So those of us who came, for example, into XR from other different ways of organizing, other, you know, priorities around which we're organizing, like, for example, racial justice, you know, we're seen as, well, this has very little to do with what XR seeks to achieve, and, you know, so kind, you know, be careful, don't come and, you know, literally muddy the waters of XR with, you know, all these ideas and experiences you're bringing, you know, just relate to us as we think you should relate. And that caused quite some challenges for a lot of people without the patience to recognize that even people who start off like could learn as things unfold as the movement gathers its own, you know, learning experiences through interactions with various forces, it could change. And that is what is happening within XR. That, you know, it's seen that other movements will rise up, you know, and bring to the fore of society's consciousness, you know, certain issues other than, you know, what XR started with. They're also realizing that there are different angles to even approaching the climate and ecological crisis. And as, you know, has been very well explained here, I mean, even the climate and ecological crisis has root causes that are directly linked, you know, to racism and racialization. You know, you can choose not to see it like that, but for many, many people, tackling racial injustice is tackling the climate and ecological crisis, you know. And if you don't see it from that perspective, they will also not see your perspective, you know. But these are all things that we're now beginning to learn. And it is a huge step forward when XR adopted a movement of movements approach, you know, in its strategy, right? Of course, this is yet to sink in. This is yet to be properly understood. This is yet to be embraced. And but then that work is going on. And for us in the Solid Manga Music campaign, also in terms of contributing to XR through the XR International Solidarity Network, which we co-founded, our point is this, that there will be the learning process within XR can be expedited if we pay, you know, the necessary attention to what is unfolding in the global south, right? And we are honest to see the full picture of what is really unfolding in the global south. Because what many people in Africa fear will be their tomorrow is today for the majority of people in the global south. And it is important that people, you know, don't shy away from looking, because one of the things this system does is to actually intimidate people away from seeing the truth, right? From questions that they choose to, or I don't want to know, you know, I don't want to see it that way, even if it's so glaring. But I think that, you know, working within XR, you know, and the kind of interactions we've been trying to develop, which are huge challenges, but it's actually encouraging more and more people to be bolder in looking at the entire global picture rather than the little angles from which they try to see, you know, things and indulge in navel gazing. And I think the more we begin to see the global picture around something like the climate and ecological crisis, that can only be understood as a global phenomenon, you know, then the more we understand. And for me, this is the key thing, you see. We have to focus our attention, if we are serious on tackling the global climate and ecological crisis, on how do we win this rebellion. You see, it's not that just going out and doing something in rebellion. We can be perpetually rebelling. And in fact, those who benefit from the way the world is would actually even fund our rebellion, so long as we are not thinking about bringing this rebellion to victory, right? And it is when you begin to look seriously at how do we win this rebellion in the shortest possible time, because none of us can afford, you know, to prolong even the rebellion, right? Then you realize that actually the forces we need to win this rebellion in the shortest possible time are the forces already, you know, who have been battle hardened by centuries of rebellion, you know, not just, you know, for national emancipation against foreign domination, but actually to defend their lands, to defend their environment, to, you know, defend their rights, you know, to have a better harmonious relationship with the environment, for whom they cannot afford to see the environment as some object of exploitation, but for whom the environment is really part of their human selves, part of their community, where all life forms are interconnected, you know, in their cosmovision, right? And, you know, once we see that most of the struggles unfolding in the majority world of the global South actually are environmental justice struggles, you know, even if they take the form of national liberation struggles, they take the form of, you know, anti-racist struggles, they are fundamentally people fighting for their rights to have, to self-determine their relationship to their environment, right? And not for people to come out there into those environments, you know, and disembowel the earth, you know, violate things they consider sacred, you know, be it forests, you know, be it water bodies, you know, be in the air, be it the animals and so on. You know, that is how we get to learn that actually if we want to win the rebellion and have a quicker solution to the climate and ecological crisis, and do what is the real challenge. The real challenge, the real thrill, as far as I'm concerned, is not rebelling against injustice. For me, I would wish that we will get over this rebellion against injustice and demonstrate our rebellion in the challenge to build a better world, right? And when we confront that, then we know that we have the forces already in rebellion across the world. And all we need to do is to get to know them, is to find ways of engaging with them so that we can build some, you know, shared positions. You know, this 1st of August thing, interestingly, has given those of us who came into the Extinction Rebellion as reparationists, as Esther, you know, as correctly said, at a time when Exile had no notion that whatever they were doing had anything to do with reparations, right? Now we are sharing a common ground where we see that the environmental justice battles are reparations battles, right? And reparations is a common ground for us to meet in the same way that the planet repairs, you know, it itself, which is the environmental justice struggles, is also a common ground, right? And we are learning that, you know, anti-racist struggle can also be a common ground, okay? So, and then issues around, you know, gender rights, you know, and so on and so forth can also be common grounds, right? But we need to explore this. We need to stop fearing each other. We need to stop building walls that divide us and explore. And that is the beauty of what XR can be. A space where we all come from different angles, even with different perspectives, but learn to open-mindedly, you know, share ideas, share experiences, and then discover this common ground that will unify us into the global force that will put a quick end to this mangamizi in the various forms in which it manifests itself, but also actually open to us the best part of rebellion, which is the rebellion not just to undo the harm, but to the rebellion to build the new. And that for me, you know, once we understand that we need to focus on winning this rebellion, then we can quickly do this because the forces are there, both in the global South and the global North, the majority and the global South. And if we have the correct relationships, you know, we will be able to win this and make the impossible happen in the shortest possible time.
As you were speaking, Kofi, I was thinking like, yeah, the forces are there, but they're in other countries. They're not here. But then as I came to understand, it's like, yeah, but like you, Kofi, have your connection to the indigenous people and you're carrying that and channeling that here. And we often think about international solidarity as being like, oh, well, there's a small group of people, they're connecting, they're helping out these other groups. But what would it mean for every rebel in Extinction Rebellion to take international solidarity seriously?
Exactly.
Having personal relationships, to have that direct connection and for that passion. You know, whilst Starbucks hides the impact of my consumption from me, that personal relationship, that real human relationship, will not hide it. Those stories will touch me and will change me and give me the fire that I need to take this seriously. Because as you're speaking, all of you, as you're speaking, I realize that I do not take this seriously enough. It's because I can hide from it. I can hide. And we need to find ways to like not hide and make that part of our culture. So I really appreciate that. And I wonder if we can work with like, to do that, to make that happen, or maybe are there movements to make that happen, to bridge that gulf, that knowledge gap, you know? Because it's a different thing, like reading about it, watching a YouTube video about it, and speaking to people about it and building a relationship. And I also honor what Cameron was saying, that, you know, a lot of people don't want to keep explaining. But many people have never even had the opportunity to explain to a Western or white audience what their life is like and what impact our connections can have. I'm really aware of time. It's an hour long, right? But our producer sent us a message saying, take as long as you like. This is incredible. Keep it going. But I think maybe we should move towards concluding remarks. Cameron, is there anything you wanted to say in summary before we close?
I don't know about summary. I had another.
No, not summary. Just summarize everything that was said.
Okay. So I'm also quite a strategically minded person. I also am aware that a lot of people in XR would have heard, we need to care about this. But what XR is, and you know, XR is a really strategic group. So a lot of people are thinking, yeah, but how can we make it work? So I'm going to try and speak about that briefly.
Yeah, please.
I hope that's a good way.
Yeah. Make it practical, make it tangible.
Yeah. The only problem though, you guys told me at the beginning, we have to find disagreements. The only problem I have with what has been said so far is that saying we need to find ways to care, we need to bridge that gulf. I think that's a good idea, but we need to basically it ignores the fact that there we exist in like power systems, you know, and so does Extinction Rebellion. Different groups with different ideas have power over organizations to different levels. So one thing I'd point to specifically is Extinction Rebellion used to much more specifically, but it has this idea that we need to remain apolitical in order to appeal to the most people. So that was an idea Extinction Rebellion had, especially as it grew from the beginning. And race was seen as political. So that's one main reason why this idea hasn't grown into something that can be employed. The other thing is that Extinction Rebellion, people go and look at its demands, its principles and values, and they say, this is what XR is. So things that deviate, you know, that's a real threat to our success. That's not true. XR is a creative and strategic and serious response to the climate crisis. And it's not going to remain that way if we're hampered by sticking rigidly to specific demands or specific principles and values. We need to be able to really creatively shift XR in order to match the political landscape as it changes, but also our furthered understandings of what the climate crisis is and where it comes from. So if we drop our fear of really changing XR, then I think we can really do this. And one way we can do this is we attach a new framing. So instead of thinking, well, we're going to alienate liberals and conservatives if we talk about, you know, systems and race, but we start thinking, well, actually, politics doesn't work like that anymore. Now, our politics in the UK is defined by people who feel disenfranchised. That's the major development of the last sort of 9-10 years. So we're looking at those people And we have to connect their everyday experience of disenfranchisement, whether it's being a racial minority, whether it's being a woman, whether it's being a working class person. We have to connect that to the climate crisis. So we have to say things like, the climate crisis is the biggest attack on working class people in human history. Or the climate crisis is the biggest attack on Black and Indigenous and people of color in human history, because it is. And we have to say that those people, that we have to point out the people who are causing the crisis. We have to say those corporations, those governments who have made your life like this, now want to leave your children a broken world. We can't allow that. So we really have to connect those experiences people have and the climate crisis. Another thing is that XR is very good at uniting people who care about the environment, at least a little bit. I'm someone who, before I came into XR, I didn't care about the environment at all. I don't have a connection to nature. I don't have a connection to animals. I do more now, but I didn't then. And the reason why I cared is because I saw the climate crisis as that, as an attack on all of us, on people everywhere. So that's something we need to really, you know, make really prominent in our framing. And the other thing is, you know, the other reason why I joined these sorts of groups is because I saw the climate crisis not just as avoiding catastrophe, although it is. You know, our movements aren't just about avoiding catastrophe. Mm-hmm. It's actually about building a whole new world. Mm-hmm. We have an opportunity that like no other generation has to end colonialism, to completely mm-hmm. rebuild our societies. We have to take it. And so I start thinking and start talking about, you know, the kind of world we can really build. We can build a world of bountiful free time. We can build a world where we respect each other properly. We have all resources that we need to survive. We have bountiful wilderness to enjoy, where our societies aren't extremely warped by the will of a small elite of people. And I'm thinking about that. I'm thinking, well, that's something worth fighting for. So maybe we should talk about that a bit more.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Cameron. Esther?
Yeah, and that's a great place, because that's what, in terms of the repair, we talk about stopping the harm is the first step to repair. And we have a notion in terms of what we're organizing. This is Stop the Mangamizi, We Charge Genocide, Ecocide campaign in particular. And we have this notion that our own African heritage community repair process is being done in such a way that is catalyzing and aligning with the repair processes of other members of the human family. And so even though for us, ultimately, what we'd like to see is a repaired Africa, which is our homeland, that we continue to be dispossessed of, and I want the right to an African, you know, identity, African, a sense of belonging to that mother continent, whether I live there or not. But we recognize that that in itself is not enough if the world around us is in disrepair. So we talk about this repaired Africa that we refer to as Ma'at Ubuntu Man in Ubuntu Dunia. And that's really a repaired Africa in a repaired world. Yeah. A world of global justice, Ubuntu and Dunia, meaning a sort of multipolar world based on pluriversality, recognizing communalism and the ways in which communities have been developing resilience, not only over decades, but over centuries, and learning from that, because that's why we're still here. So it's big picture stuff, but we're engaged in that process already. And one of the aspects of actually being located here in Britain is that Britain had empire. And so we find ourselves in this country interfacing, interrelating with so many other peoples who also experienced empire. And that's one of the beauties, because we can have these discussions and we can actually cross-fertilize around the change-making efforts that we are engaged in, both locally, nationally, in terms of this country, but also internationally, linking back, especially into our home countries, which many of us still do. So that's the beauty of this, that it's a process that's taking place at many different levels. Mm. And it's really for us all to just find our own level and strengthen that and find others who are also connected at that level. And it is that prefigurative politics. We are building the new the shell of the old. We are doing that. Reparations is a process. So, you know, this might sound, but it's true. And that's how we see it. And we're just doing our little bit in this time as in our generation. And the next generation that's coming up now will have their own way of relating to this. So, yeah, the future is bright, but we don't have much time to figure this out. Yeah. We don't have that much time. And I would say that in Extinction Rebellion International Solidarity Network, and as we've been there from, you know, early 2019, I would say fully, there has been that space, because our own purpose for existing was about creating this two-way learning between those in XR who came, especially the founders, co-founders who came from a particular experience, life experience, worldview, but many of us who came from others. And we created that space. It was initially marginalized. A lot of people didn't know about us. Of course, we've had the same struggles that many others have had, but we've always been there. And actually now we're beginning to see, and there's a number of reasons why that's happening, but there's a lot more receptivity, a lot more receptivity. And the mere fact that we have, a solidarity effort in joining us in a very African heritage, you know, the African-led rebellion that takes place on the 1st of Mosiah, August, is an indication of that. Last year, a few members came out, about 10. This year, it's a whole lot different. And there is this recognition of the planet repairs that Kofi mentioned about, which are holistic repairs, including the repair that we have to do, and stopping the harm to our environment, the earth that sustains all of our lives, no matter how we call ourselves or what part of this earth that we were born on, or our parents or grandparents or even lineages come from.
Thank you for your patience in that process. I know I'm silently patient, but thank you so much for your patience. And I hope that, I hope you're right. I don't even hope you're right. I know you're right. Things are different. People are waking up, people are realizing, and people are changing. I think the thing that I feel like has been left out here that I'd like to just touch upon, because it's kind of the work that I'm working on with a few people like Julie and Davey, is it's almost like in the guise that XR is, I think we may have reached our limit or our cap with how many people are going to sign up to be a rebel with Extinction Rebellion. And for me, that's really okay. It's really okay. One thing we've noticed in trying to create local movements around racial injustice is that there are some really subtle elements of Extinction Rebellion culture that are just exclusive to other groups. And it's very little things like waving hands or check-ins and stuff like that. Just the language you use, we think, oh, that's surely nothing, but actually is quite an exclusive thing. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, rather than, and this is, it came to, we realized this earlier on, it is a form of like colonialism or white supremacy to expect everyone to do things in the way in which we do things, mm-hmm. because it works for us. And actually part of the movement of movements isn't just to join up with other movements, but it's also to create new movements around people's struggles. So there's people we're working with now who haven't done any political organizing before, and they're coming together around a certain issue. They're newly awakened activists, and we're now thinking of an organizing structure, values, principles, ways of working, etc. And one thought we had was, well, Extinction Rebellion's got loads of those. Let's just put that on this group. But actually, if we want to be creating new movements, each of these movements needs to understand its own aims, mission, values, purpose, ways of organizing and working that works for that group. And that will be attractive to that group and that particular issue with that particular cultural background here locally in Tottenham or wherever it is. And then for them to be intimately linked and connected with Extinction Rebellion, with all the other movements and groups that are out there. And yeah, I guess if people are interested in how we go about, rather than just being a big movement, but a movement of movement builders, activists who are able to go out, find communities and their struggle, and help them to build a movement of empowered activists who are going to engage in rebellion, then yeah, get in touch and we can kind of talk about that, because I think that's the missing piece here. That's the missing piece. Yo, look, thank you so much. Kobe's not here. Kobe's let's say his phone ran out of battery or something, but thank you so much. This was great. I cannot wait to see everyone on Saturday on the first of Messiah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much.